Well, it's great to be back with you for another GoldSeek.com Radio Gold Nugget segment. Today's special guest, Peter Grandich. Market analyst Peter Grandich says that the bears could be losing their hold on this market. So it's a pleasure to have him back on the show. Market commentator for MoneyTalks.net. Hello, Peter.
Thank you for having me as always.
With the Dow and the S&P 500 now hitting all-time highs, we're seeing the FOMC comments from last week's meeting talk about holding the benchmark lending rate for another year at these lows. We're also seeing inflation beginning to heat up with the PPI and CPI inching higher. This sounds like good news for stocks, but even better news for the precious metals.
First of all, I would caution you, while we constantly hear about new record highs, these record highs are kind of within a fairly defined range. They are not spread out or much more percentage higher than they were just a few weeks ago. So while you hear that, it's not something that's made a lot of ground. Second of all, yes, some inflation is good for equities, and there's certainly no question that it's the lesser of two evils to equities that it is for bonds. Inflation is detrimental to bonds. I would be very cautious to say that that is going to be a positive reason why the equity market continue going higher. In fact, I have been looking for now a top here between last Friday's triple reaching and the next employment report. And the reason the employment report is still significant, it's the last one where the government uses a variety of seasonally adjusted and other numbers to create a much better employment environment than really exists. And I think once that's out of the way, the reality of a rather weak economy and overpriced equity and very overpriced bond market and the inevitable turn up in interest rates is going to not bode well for financial assets, meaning equities and bonds.
You know, as of Tuesday, we've certainly seen a lot of volatility enter these markets. I told my subscribers and listeners last week that I was quite concerned by the excessive bullishness that we're seeing in the sentiment indicators here. We monitor that more closely even than price. We saw excessive bullishness to one of the most extreme levels that I've seen last Friday. Well, frankly, since this bull market began in 2009-ish, people were just euphoric and usually does not accompany new highs. During every single new high that we've seen on a weekly basis, since 2009, always been accompanied by very low interest by investors, strong bearish sentiment. But I also wanted to ask you about geopolitical tensions that are starting to ratchet up in the Middle East. And I'm sure you've heard about Iraq, one of the largest oil exporting countries still. Some concerns there that we've just lost one of the country's largest refineries to the insurgents. Could have a destabilizing effect or impact, I think, on the nation and the region, potentially. I don't know if you've heard, but several thousand Iranian troops have been sent into the region. We've sent over about 300 people to help stabilize things. Investors are concerned here, and I think justifiably so. The U.S. could send, you know, more troops, larger, you know, maritime fleet. I think we've even evacuated the embassy. I'd like your thoughts on this and just what it might mean for the markets, please.
I think on the geopolitical side of things, when it comes particularly to our equity market, those who have seemingly have not been around, as you said yourself and myself now in my fourth decade, have greatly discounted and believed that geopolitical concerns somehow no longer impact the markets in a negative manner. I think that's a very poor choice by those people and will come back to bite them. In this particular case, because it's in such an important part of the world where energy prices come from, and knowing that the world's economy at best in the last few years has been tempered, any significant rise in oil prices that are sustainable will cut into whatever's left of GDP growth. And so I think it's a very important thing to look at. But I think the other thing that escapes is the presidency, and literally there is no real foreign policy or nothing to point to, not only here in the country but abroad, that will say that this president and his administration has left its mark. Iraq is really a disaster. It wasn't too long ago that Vice President Biden was speaking openly about it. It was the mark of how great the Obama administration has done on foreign policy. And it's just no matter where you look around the world, there are geopolitical hotspots that can impact us all. So I just think that the only reason the president has not been terribly banged up in the daily rants of people is that the stock market has risen during his administration. Credit or not, I'm not here to argue that, but people have had a false sense that the economy has got to get better, even though it's not good for me right now, because look at the stock market, it's going up, so one day it's going to get better for me, so I'm not going to complain a lot at this point. And I think when the stock market turns down, and I think that time is coming, then the last bastion of, or the last rock that this president and administration could hide behind will be removed. And then all the half-empty viewpoints will come to the forefront, and that'll be a negative for financial assets, but be a positive for hard assets.
I'd also like your thoughts on the Fed's latest from last week's meeting. You know, according to the Fed statement, beginning in July, they will add to their holdings of mortgage-backed securities at a slower pace than before. As we know, they dropped their stimulus by about $10 billion for the fifth time in a row. But what I find interesting here is this new verbiage they've added into the statements. This was brought to my attention by Navalier and Associates. They're going to reinvest some of these funds. And according to a couple of sources here, this term reinvestment may be the Fed's attempt at QE4. We're seeing their balance sheet continue to inch higher now. When I say inch higher, $4.4 trillion. It seems like just a few years ago it was at $800 billion. We've entered a whole new paradigm of money expansion here. This new sobriquet, reinvestment, a couple of inside sources are claiming that that is just camouflage for further Fed stimulus. I'd like your thoughts.
I find it impossible that there has not been more discussion. Well, I shouldn't say that, because in the financial journalism world, and most that we listen to from the main financial houses, are not going to talk about things that could be possibly negative. So I take that back, but I do surprisingly not find in the independent minds that are still out there that there's still such little talk about the record amount of what the Fed's balance sheet has gone to, and how do you unwind that without disrupting the markets. And I agree with you in this sense. I believe that the moment the markets turn down, and they turn down hard, and that is coming, the cries will go out for the Fed to put on its Superman uniform again. And one of the things they'll do is they'll go back into some type of quantitative easing mode. And it's not like we haven't seen this before. And I keep pointing this out to people. I think the United States has started down the road that Japan started back in the late 80s. And that is, you know, quantitative easing forever. And that is what has happened in Japan, and it's been stagnant. And I think the same is going to be true for America. There is no corner, because they've been painted into it, the Fed, and no one wants to go through. They had the opportunity in 2008 to allow for an unwinding of debt through a difficult, if not depressionary, type economy for a few years, and no one is willing to take that medicine here in the United States, and therefore the only avenue that will inevitably go down is an avenue that Japan went down. So I agree with you. There'll be some sort of QE, whatever they call it, or whatever way they disguise it, but it will come when the economy turns down and the market turns down. And once we're 10 to 20% from the highs and employment is not getting any better, it will be turned to the Fed. And what's really amazing about that, it's not worthy of a long discussion, is when I was in this thing 30 years ago, it wasn't the Fed that was looked upon to help and build the economy. It was Washington. It was always the Congress that would hopefully enact legislation and do things with regulation and what have you to build an economy, and not the Federal Reserve's job to maintain the economy. But like it or not, and I think it's partly its predecessor's fault, but the Fed chairman has become, because of Washington's inability really to be any effective anymore, has become the person group or in charge of the economy, and that isn't what their job was supposed to be. And so I agree with you that I just think that whatever they call it and however they disguise it, inevitably will go back to more and more reason. And that is the sniff that I believe has helped stabilize the decline in the precious gold market and has now given it a lift. And the fact that inflation, a word that has not been used in the market for years and years, is a reality again, and that the fears of deflationary environment are dissipating, and people are looking at the possibility of inflation. And in the end, people that forgot about it, that had been for many, many years one of the main driving forces for gold, and I think it's going to return as well.
Well, you make two fantastic points I'd like to touch on here briefly. Firstly, with regard to the former Fed Volcker, if you read his comments, he's been quite vocal with regard to the fact that we really require further fiscal. They have, as you've said, shouldered the burden of responsibility for economic growth on the Federal Reserve. And as I think you also aptly point out, that is not their responsibility. The Fed's mandate was clearly just to maintain stable markets, and in particular, currency stability. The other thing you touched on, and I think this is really key here, it's the crux, a lost generation. Take a look at Japan. Well, there's a brilliant new study, and they make five or six fascinating points that I think are very salient to our economy today. The Great Depression here in the United States, as well as the lost generation in Japan. And they drew some startling parallels between what occurred in both instances and what is and could occur here in the United States. That people had to fall back on family. They had to be able to count on their high morality of the society. They had to fall back to those basic values on the family farm. Interview after interview of people still living today who had lived through the Great Depression, how we don't know what we would have done if we couldn't have fallen back to the family farm, you know, Steinbeck tradition of the grapes of wrath. If we keep with this idea and we move forward to the lost generation in Japan, what I thought was interesting is they talked about how we were able to graduate from school, sign up with a company, and we would work there for the next 30 or 40 years. And you could count on it. I mean, you were loyal to the company and the company took care of you from cradle to grave. As the economic sea change came, then all the people graduating afterwards had nowhere to go because there were no jobs. They couldn't bring them on. They were already saturated, and then the whole system imploded. I think if we take those two situations, where is the morality? Where is the safety net for the typical American?
It's built on false hopes, and that's why the entitlement issue has gotten so out of hand. People have, in a sense, and I don't want to say that or begin to paint a picture that every single person on entitlement program doesn't want to work or what have you, but we have made it to a point of where it does call into question, should I work at such low income levels when affordably I could do as well, if not better, with a variety of entitlement programs at both the federal, state, and local level. And that is that's an issue that may not be spoken about each day, but because of some involved in civics, I can tell you is faced by local, state, and federal leaders, and people have, in a sense, become used to and expecting the government to do everything. And, you know, we had a big, terrible storm here a couple of years ago, Hurricane Sandy. There has been a feeling among people that the government is responsible to take care of everything and make everything that it was new. And I've argued and sometimes have gotten into some trouble because I live near the shore, of people saying that, you know, I think if someone decides to build a $6 zillion home with 3 feet away from the ocean, with not raised up, I don't think that my tax dollars should be spent to fix that home up again. If they wanted to do that and took their chances, that should be it. And it's just one of zillions of issues where people have, in a sense, grown entitled to something. And my dad, who passed away in the late 80s, used to say that once people go from something that is really a gift to versus they believe it's an entitlement, it's hard, if not impossible, to take it back. And I just think we've gotten people conditioned to expecting government to be there, and government takes advantage of that by doing that and giving just enough to people to the point of that, well, I better keep these people in power because this is the only way this is going to continue for me. And that's the great argument. And there is a backlash growing. I will say this. There is clearly a feeling that throw the bums out, no matter what side of the aisle they're on, if they've been there a while, and start with somebody fresh. I think what took place in Virginia a couple weeks ago and today down in Mississippi and others, I think we're going to read about longtime both Democrat and Republican incumbents being tossed and being voted out by people with little or no political experience running in their place. I really believe there's a feeling, a movement in America, or throw the bums out, and I think it's going to increase, particularly, as I said, the last saving grace that has really stopped everything from unwinding has been the equity market, and the Fed knows that. There's no question that they know that, but inevitably, gravity will take hold, and when that time comes, all these other problems we just discussed are really going to come to the forefront.
I'm sure you've heard the expression that once folks learn that they can vote into office officials who will give them those entitlements, the system is doomed to collapse. And there's another interesting quote, I think, that follows here from Voltaire, who said, "Money always returns to its intrinsic value, paper money, that is, zero." In other words, it has no value. And so I think when we combine the two, and it's a vicious cycle, which I think you were alluding to, you know that once they open up Pandora's box, there's no way they can stop it. The only way to get elected is to promise more goodies, and the only way to stay in the office is increase the entitlement. Eventually, the music has to stop. The Federal Reserve Chairman, obviously, I think came off a little bit more dovish following the last meeting than many people expected. We saw the dollar rally get capped. The Fed is not offering any time frame on future rate hikes. Then they noted that there's no fixed algorithm in their decision regarding their benchmark lending rates.
My opinion on gold was that in the latter stages of major moves, either up or down, certain people pile in too late on that move. And in this particular case, there was a technical pattern a few months ago that it's setting up. It broke down. Everybody's mother seemed to have written that that meant that gold was about to collapse. A variety of people got very short, particularly the hedge fund community. They did not understand what we have talked about for quite a while, that the physical market has been getting stronger and stronger, and one day would override whatever the paper pushes do. I think that occurred. We saw, whatever the excuse may be, the Fed's comment, whatever it was, a tremendous short covering rally begin. Inevitably, big bear markets in any type of market, not just gold, begin off of short covering rallies because at the end of a bear market, everybody thinks, just as they do during a great bull market, that a way of making money, in this case, is to the short side, was caught. It turns the market around. It gives it a foothold that allow fundamentals to go from half empty to half full. That's what I think is happening in gold. But I think the difference in this gold rally than any gold rally that we've had for several years is as it starts to mature and starts to work higher, I think inflation and inflation numbers are going to play a positive role on it. And I think people, it's still shocking to me. I'm amazed that the average person out there can go out and buy a 10-year bond for 2.62% when they know everything they're paying for is going up in price far more than that. But I also think as they view that there's been no other alternative but to do that. But I think some of that alternative is going to be viewed in gold as it was in the 70s, and people will start to use gold as an inflation hedge again, something that has not been spoken out a lot of mouths for a few decades.
Real interest rates are key here. And we've seen for years now this relationship hold up, high negative correlation between low rates and high gold prices. Larry Summers wrote a seminal paper on it that essentially showed that negative rates virtually guarantees a gold bull market. The ECB enters negative rate territory, the first major central bank to do so on record. I can't think of a more positive sign for the precious metals. Any thoughts?
Yeah, there's just a variety of things that make it strong. I want to point out that since the highs 2011, there's no question in my mind there has been a movement among certain groups, people, whatever they are, named or unnamed, to move the paper market down, hoping it would cause a tremendous capitulation in the physical market to allow large sums to come back to the people who are short that have lent out, and in a sense, what we saw recently in China, gave out, used gold more than once in selling it. And in this particular case, it hasn't worked for them. While they got the paper price down, they did not see large quantities of bullion come back. And now they've been caught. There's been enough media attention, although not any close to what it's deserving of, to problems of governments asking for gold and not being able to secure it. Ironically, last night, a story Bloomberg ran about how Germany suddenly has decided that, no, the United States, it's okay, the gold's there, we're not going to bother with it. And then suddenly, several hours later, have to retract that story because it wasn't true. I just think that was another planet story that's happened from time to time in hopes of causing a significant sell-off last night because the paper market's starting to get out of hand to them. We're not there yet. I still think, as I've said for months, we need to get above $1,400 in gold. I think we're getting there. I just think, again, that what has held the gold market together has been people's desire, particularly outside of North America, to own physical metals in lieu of paper currencies, and as well as for geopolitical concerns as well. And I just think that's growing. It's now getting a foothold in North America. We're starting to see people be interested in that and be concerned about that. And I think the combination of both now are going to have kicked off and started a new upleg for gold and silver.
No, it really is the only foxhole available. I mean, every municipality, every country, every family, and every individual, unfortunately, has to take that army-issued shovel and dig their own foxhole amid incoming munitions. The only opportunity you have to protect yourself against inevitable purchasing power erosion, the everyday person you talk to and the economic tutelage that they may have under their belt was so skewed in a system where information has been eroded as the U.S. dollar. People are just starving for the truth. They see their grocery bill soaring, cost of prescriptions going up. They know that their rent is going up, price at the pump. And just across the board, this is a universal theme. As you say, inflation is going to be a persistent problem for all investors and for just individuals who have very little to invest in. And if we look at the numbers, less than half of Americans apparently have access to $2,000 or more should an emergency arise. Now, there is some question whether or not that includes IRAs and retirement funds. But my point simply is that people just don't have access to a lot of money because for the most part, they're living paycheck to paycheck or in the worst case scenario, playing a game of musical credit cards. Peter Grandich, any other topics that you'd like to leave with the listening audience?
I'll just say that earlier in our conversation, one of the points I wanted to get across, and I should have, and I'll do that to close, and that is, in a planning business that we have here, and it reaches out to North America with an associate up in Canada, there's a complacency that has overtaken most people. People either have felt that they have missed this market and therefore they wish not to do anything, or they're in the market and just feel it's going to continue to go forever and not be concerned about changing environment. And that complacency combined with what you said earlier about how basically seemingly all the bears have disappeared from the equity equity market, and there was an overriding of bullishness, is the classic mood environment that takes place just before a significant event or events happen to radically change that. So if there was any time we have spoken that I am as close to convinced of a market move, and not, I don't want to say the word guarantee because I've learned that after three decades you can't, but if ever we've been close to a significant change in a market, the equity market is that market, and all these signs that we just spoke about are screaming for those of us who've experienced it before that this is the classic telltale signs that take place before that happens. So I really feel that it won't be too long. It certainly won't be, we won't need to see snow again before we will be talking about a substantial decline in the equity market as far as I'm concerned.
All the dominoes are lined up, I mean, in a row. I mean, we've just had one of the more spectacular rallies in years, and eventually, at some point, that's more than likely going to have to come to an end. And, you know, really now that the Fed has, in some ways, I think, put the brakes on the economy, you have to wonder just what's going to sustain this. Corporate profits are beginning to slide, and as we know, that really is the engine. I think one of the things that's helping to hold things up right now, we have a very, according to the government, at least, their numbers, a solid job market. And as you know, the consumer makes up over 70% of the economy. So they're feeling a bit euphoric for the most part, and they're spending what they're earning. But what they may have forgotten is that most of those jobs are low-paying jobs relative to pre-Great Recession 2008. When times do get tough, it's going to just, I think, exacerbate the situation all the more. Peter Granditch, give folks an idea how they can find out about your work, please.
One, I write for moneytalks.net, one word, moneytalks.net, and our planning business is Trinity Financial Sports and Entertainment Management. It's too long to describe the website to you, but I'm sure people can reach out to you and you can forward to us if they have any interest.
This is must read every day. Bookmark Peter's website, inspirational quotes, all kinds of great ideas. And, you know, he just puts it out there for everybody. So, you know, this is must-have information. We're going to look forward to having you back on the show, sir.
Always a pleasure. Thank you.